in a country like India, there are so many other basic things that need to be taken care of, right? Sport is considered as luxury in that sense. So why sport?
The Corporate Social Responsibility Act sort of addresses or looks to address a milieu of these issues that India faces. How do you, as an organization, compete with these sort of competing interests that exist within Section 7 portfolio?
Every 4 years, we as a country keep wondering why we don't have Olympic medalists. So, you know, that's really usually my answer, that if you want that to happen, there needs to be an 8-year, 10-year investment. Whatever you're seeing now, the fact that India has become a multi-sport nation, we Indians know who a PV Sindhu is, a Deepa Karmakar is, we know who our hockey players, Rani Rampal is, you know, we know a Shri Jish. All of this is because there have been investments by different stakeholders. And you've seen the power of sport. Sport has that unique ability to put India on a world map. When the mandate came out for CSR, sport was initially not part of that mandate. And it was a very generic towards sports training. But at that point of time, Abhinav Bindra actually needs to get a lot of credit on that. He wrote back to the ministry, and to the company affairs team and mentioned that if it can be more specific towards what areas of sport, and that's when they included Olympic, Paralympic, rural sports, and training towards that. But why should a corporate invest in CSR? It's multifold, I think. It's not only because of a medal, right? Medal is an outcome. But if you're talking education, it's a very similar form of education that you're doing. It's just that child is using sport instead of actually studying. In that process, what also happens is you're creating livelihood for those people. We've had an opportunity to be part of some incredible athlete journeys where, we have one swimmer called Supriyo Mondal. He's actually a fisherman's son. And we picked him up 10 years ago, actually. And when he came into the foundation, someone spotted him in a state level event and said, he's supremely talented and this kid needs to be supported. And 10 years now, when we see the child today speaks English, is fit, has a job with the railways, he's broken the cycle of poverty and he's not going to go back to being a fisherman, right? So I think the power of sport is incredible. You're just using sport, but ultimately you're still meeting all those SDGs of the UN. You're creating role models at the end of the day. So I think that
would you say that perception amongst corporates is changing in terms of soliciting or contributing to India's sports cause, be it at the grassroots or at the elite level athlete?
I think it is definitely changing from when we started to where it is today. Definitely there is a lot of changes. Today, I think if you're a corporate investing in sport, you'll definitely get recognized much more than a corporate in women's empowerment and thing, because there are thousands of other companies in that area. Very few companies very nichely investing into sport can, be seen as the people changing the narrative and changing a particular sport. For example, Rani Rampal, she's actually a cart puller's daughter from a very small town in Haryana. And this was 10 years back. She's one of our first few athletes who we gave a scholarship to. And it was just a monthly stipend, but it meant so much to her. And today to see her leading the Indian hockey team, right? It just all comes together. Yes, it's taken 10-12 years and we stopped supporting her after she started doing well. But today when you look back at that region, at that community, the number of other hockey players coming out of there, the female infanticide ratio has actually, that percentage has gone down. There's a lot of other aspects that because of sport, it's changing the narrative and changing communities and individuals as well.